Welcome to the podcast series on National Education Policy 2020 by the Center of Excellence in Teacher Education Initiative at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. For this podcast, we plan to interview educationists and other stakeholders to share their responses and insights on different chapters of the education policy. Over to our host of today.
Today we have Dr. Meera Chandran with us to talk about NEP 2020 with regard to teachers. Dr. Meera Chandran is Assistant Professor at Center for Education, Innovation and Action Research at Tata Institute of Social Sciences. She teaches master courses in teacher education, education development and policy, and research methodology. She is the research leader of Connected Learning Initiative and co-PI for the Government of India SparkLex project for conducting research, design workshops, and develop case studies. National Education Policy 2020 has boldly attempted to bring about structural changes both in school education and higher education. Teachers are central to any education system and they deserve respect and attention from the state and the society. NEP 2020 has Chapter 5 dedicated to teachers that talks about recruitment and deployment of the teachers, raising and maintaining the status of the teachers by introducing incentives and initiating the process of professionalization of the teachers. In the conversation with Dr. Meera, we wish to build an understanding of what NEP 2020 has incorporated and missed in this respect. Welcome, ma'am. The previous education policies advocated for raising the status of the teachers. However, not much improvement in the status of the teachers was seen on ground. How does NEP 2020 approach and respond to the issue of declining status of the teachers? Do you think the policy gives promising ways to improve the status of the teachers in the society?
Yeah, thanks, Shweta. So, you know, even the NEP of 1986, it had this statement that it declared that no society can rise above the level of its teachers. So we've had such policy pronouncements that place teachers on a high pedestal. But this has become, more of a rhetoric rather than a substantive policy offering. So before we get into the NEP 2020, I would like us to first consider the present status of teachers. You know, we are living through this unfortunate pandemic, which has actually in a strange way brought home to us the, important role that teachers play in the education of our children. However, in the years preceding that, we cannot deny that teachers' status has actually diminished in the public eye, and there have been calls for minimizing their role and even teacher-proofing the classrooms. So in the previous decade, if you know, many state governments have appointed teachers without professional qualifications, undermining teachers' professional status. So this was largely a policy position that emerges from a view which we understand now as to be a purely economic efficiency kind of an argument. So in this argument, if you see, educational outcomes are seen mostly in terms of inputs and outputs. So teacher salaries, which is arguably the highest component of a state's education budget, that is considered to be an input, while student learning, learning outcome in large scale tests in particular, that is considered as the output. Now, government schools are regarded as inefficient as they are unable to produce these outcomes that private schools do at much lower costs. So there is a fundamental problem here in reducing the educational aims to merely students' performance in tests. So even if we do for a moment, for the sake of an argument, accept this kind of an approach, we cannot ignore the historical and structural problems faced by our school systems. So the high enrollments that have happened in the recent years in the government schools in particular, particularly from homes where there are first generation school goers, it calls for a reimagining of teachers' roles. But unfortunately, this is also the time when teachers have faced a backlash of both policy and public pressure for greater accountability, and not from any pedagogic standpoint, but purely from an input-output kind of an efficiency standpoint. So this is one problem. In my view, the other problem is that there is an important dimension of the status of teacher education. So the high level of commercialization of teacher education institutions and their poor quality has resulted in a weak professional status of teachers. So this is the second dimension of the problem as I see it. Now the RTE Act was an important landmark in making the professional qualifications of teachers mandatory across all levels, right? So this was a very crucial step in the right direction. And the National Curricular Framework for Teacher Education also provided the broad structure to revamp the largely ossified teacher education curriculum. So coming to the NEP 2020, one hopes that it will help to consolidate the processes that have already been set in motion through the RTE and the NCFTE. And what we need right now is for the NEP to reinforce the professionalization of teaching and put a stop to further appointment of unqualified teachers, which was already on the wane. The big question, of course, is what happens to teachers within the system? And as the policy states, we must ensure decent working conditions for teachers, so that they can be appointed in areas where there are teacher vacancies. And I feel that professionalization, providing decent working conditions, autonomy within the systemic support for teachers, and consistent opportunities for professional and career growth, all of these are what will go a long way in raising the status of teachers in a very meaningful way.
The policy emphasizes a lot on the discourse of outstanding teachers. How do you understand this?
You know, the policy NEP 2020, if you read it, it employs the word outstanding in several places while it refers to teachers' recruitment and deployment. And your question is very valid. One does not clearly, you know, understand, or one is not very clear what is meant by this term outstanding, and why a policy document should employ a term that is so vague and open to such varied interpretations. So I can only interpret in my way. So the way in which I would interpret or I could interpret the word is to say that perhaps it is the reference to the low quality of professionals in teaching and the need of the hour to attract the best of students into the profession. This is the one interpretation that I could make. And it would seem that the NEP is probably trying to make try to avoid making any kind of broad brush assessments about the quality of people who make teaching their career choice. While this may not necessarily be an issue, I think it would be better for the policy to have clearly spelled out the reasons for the status quo and the strategies that are required to change the status quo. So as I mentioned in my earlier response, I feel it is really the professionalization of teaching that the energies of the state machinery and the resources of the state must be devoted towards.
What does policy consider an adequate knowledge base for the teachers? What is your view on continuous professional development of the teachers as proposed by NEP 2020?
You know, the policy does mention continuing professional development of teachers. In my view, other than changing this terminology from the archaic TPD, the teacher professional development, to the more contemporary CPD, I feel that this particular section appears to be the weakest, one of the weakest sections with regards to teachers in the NEP. So if you remember in the SSA period, we saw an explosion of TPD activity where teachers were required to undergo a certain number of workshops in any given year. So studies have shown that these workshops were highly ritualistic in nature, and very little actually was achieved by these efforts. Now, with the NEP 2020, I feel in some sense we seem to have swung in the other direction. So the policy mentions several modalities with a particular emphasis on the online mode, through which teachers can acquire skills in different areas. And some of the areas are actually a bit, one is not clear why literacy and numeracy should be part of the skills that teachers should acquire at this stage. Areas like assessment as well. And I feel that there seems to be a severe lack of imagination with regard to the nature and purpose of continuing professional development, through which teachers can be supported in their practice. Now, there is enough evidence to show that practitioners can learn through meaningful interactions in a community of practice. And this mode of acquiring a bunch of CPD certificates over a number of hours of online engagement without real learning that leads to better practice somehow does not seem like a step in the right direction to me. Also, there is no mention in this NEP of the role of institutions of teacher education that are well established, such as the DIETs, in creating these CPD courses and also supporting teachers through their learning. And the district and block level personnel who are appointed for this very purpose can actually play a very important role in providing their academic support to teachers for which they need training. So this is also not mentioned in the NEP. I feel that on these two very important accounts, the NEP does seem to be rather silent.
NEP 2020 says, quote, "Teachers will be given more autonomy in choosing finer aspects of pedagogy so that they may teach in the manner that they find most effective for the students in their classrooms and communities." Quote, how can one imagine a teacher in the classroom and communities?
See, teacher autonomy is, to my mind, a rather complex phenomenon. So in the case of in the Indian teacher, it is on the one hand linked to the position of teachers in the hierarchy of the educational system, that is within the educational bureaucracy. And historically, you will know that teachers have occupied a very low position in the system. And this is further compounded by their low professional status, which is linked to their professional training. So professionalization of teaching can, to some extent, provide teachers with the autonomy that is direly needed. However, the bigger issue here is the institutional culture that has become increasingly managerial over the years. And there has been a tendency to blame the teacher for anything that ails the schooling system, which has to be replaced with a culture of shared accountability. So rather than micromanaging teachers' routine work, I feel that there has to be a culture of responsibility towards achieving the best outcomes for children as a shared responsibility of all the stakeholders that are there in the school community.
How will the creation of school complexes bring changes to the role of the teachers? How will the idea of sharing teachers across the school complex influence their role in the larger context of school as well as the complex?
See, teachers, there is a need for teachers to be a part of a professional learning community, as I mentioned before. And teaching can be a very isolating experience. And teachers, like every other professional, they need opportunities to work together and learn from peers. And the idea of a school complex is, in this NEP, is proposed as a means to create that sense of community amongst teachers. So therefore, in that sense, it is a welcome move. However, creating school complexes itself is not the answer, right? In fact, in the name of consolidation and rationalization of schools, many states have begun shutting down small schools. And I feel that this is a dangerous development, as it cuts off access to children who are already at risk of dropping out of the school system. So school complexes also seem to serve the purpose of this kind of a rationalization of a teacher availability, and that is a completely different objective than what is trying to be achieved here, which is the establishment of a professional learning community. So these are two completely different objectives, and we must appreciate the difference here. Now, the NEP is also suggesting that creating these kinds of school complexes will automatically encourage professional learning to occur, and I think that is a mistake. Schools are notoriously heavy in their schedules, and unless authorities value the communities of learning and make time allocations towards this end, it is not going to automatically happen. And we all know that it is the structure which also tends to influence people's behaviors. So in that spirit, what we need therefore is a firm time commitment within the school schedule, to teachers engagement with professional learning communities, so that they have time within the school schedules to come together, if not on a daily basis or a weekly basis, or some kind of a scheduled way in which teachers can come together and engage in this kind of a professional learning activities. So this needs to be validated by the school authorities in order for these to happen, and they will not happen automatically as the NEP seems to suggest.
How does policy aim at scaling the recruitment and the deployment of the teachers?
So the NEP does seem to give quite a bit of importance to this aspect of teachers in the school system. So it provides guidelines for teacher recruitment and deployment. And to some extent, I feel that it is also basing these guidelines on some of the best practices that have been adopted by some states, particularly states like Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, that have highly streamlined and digitized systems of planning of the teacher recruitment and deployment. And this is definitely something that other states can also learn from and emulate. Also, the NEP seems to place a lot of emphasis on providing incentives to teachers to be deployed in places where they are there are likely to be teacher shortages. And this is also something that is quite frequently occurring in the far-flung rural areas. So therefore, such incentives is a welcome move on the part of NEP. And on the other hand, in the last few years, in many of the states, recruitment of the regular teacher cadre had been put on freeze. And this had, in fact, given a boost to privatization of schooling in many of these states, particularly in the urban and the rural areas as well. So it is actually an encouraging sign that the state is willing to make the kind of financial commitment that is needed towards recruitment and deployment of a regular teacher cadre. However, the NEP is silent, or it does not say exactly how the state financing for this will be done. So as we know, the subject of education is a concurrent one, and it is the state which has to make these kinds of financial outlays. So how this will be done by individual states which are already highly strapped for funds, and they are unable to pay their teacher salaries according to the 5th, 6th, or even the 7th, 5-year, 7th plan. So that is something that remains to be seen.
The policy introduces levels in the salary structures, promotions and incentives for the teachers based on their performance. What will be the deciding factor for the same? Do you think it will influence the teacher's sense of their own profession?
Yeah, this is a very interesting issue. So as I mentioned earlier, the political economic question in education has always been one that is closely linked to the question of the teacher's salary, as that is the biggest component of the education budget of any state. However, the proponents of the efficiency and the input-output model of public school systems have been arguing for some form of performance-based pay for teachers. So their argument is based on the assumption that teachers simply cannot be paid high salaries, and this may actually lead to some kind of lack of accountability within the system. So there can be many counter arguments to that. We will not get into those kinds of arguments here. However, the NEP seems to suggest some kind of a midway between this kind of a highly managerial way of performance-based management and the kind of system that currently exists. What the NEP is suggesting is that the teachers will receive some kind of an incentive and some kind of a merit-based pay for the best work that they can do. Now, a lot of questions open up with this kind of a terminology that is being used by the NEP, because these terms, what is best work? What is merit-based? And what would you regard as a good performance by a teacher who is working under extremely strenuous conditions where children are unable to come to school because of various home-based constraints? So these are all questions that are not something that can be answered through a simple policy document, right? So these are highly contextual issues. But however, these are also issues that are open to varied interpretations. So that is where the problem arises. The second aspect of this kind of performance-based pay and incentive-based structure in salaries, the NEP at this point is mooting a new system of, or it is trying to introduce the system of a national professional standards of teachers, which will be developed by a competent authority which it proposes to do in a couple of years' time. So my concern with regards to this kind of a standards, and this is not something which is new, it is happening, in fact, it is happening quite swiftly across the world, and the experiences across the different countries are also quite varied. So I think there is a need to also be informed by the research that is coming from these kinds of comparable contexts from across the globe before we jump into this kind of a performance-based assessment of teachers. Nonetheless, I feel that some kind of a rigorous appraisal system is not misplaced at this point. My concern is again coming from the kind of educational institutional culture that exists in the country today, and what is the level of preparedness of our educational bureaucracy for such a mechanism of teacher appraisal. And I believe that setting this kind of an appraisal system demands a certain extent of maturity of the institutional system, which is currently not in place. And therefore, the efforts have to be first made to create this kind of an environment where such, historical biases against teachers, or even biases stemming from social cultural differences, those need to be addressed so that a conducive environment for this kind of a performance-based management system can be instituted and run in a fair manner.
Is NEP 2020 vocal about what will happen to the existing teachers? What does the policy's silence on the situation of the existing teachers imply?
Yes, I think you're right in some sense that the policy goes into great detail about recruitment of new teachers, deployment of teachers, the standards for teachers to be recruited, their performance management, and so on. However, it does seem to be rather silent on the status of teachers, particularly teachers who are not employed on a regular basis. Right? So there have been quite a number of teachers across different states who have been recruited on a contractual basis. So the NEP does not explicitly talk about the status or the future or the employment prospects of these teachers. So in one sense, I think this is understandable. So as I mentioned previously, this education being a concurrent subject, the teacher recruitment policies are quite varied across states. So while some states began a recruitment of para teachers in a big way in the early 2000s. And they actually withdrew this whole system in the later years. And some other states came into it much later. And to a large extent, most states have, if not stopped it, but they have definitely not expanded their recruitments of para teachers. So this is something that is a very sticky subject because it directly links to the state's finances. So the NEP does not clearly, although in the draft NEP, there was a firm commitment towards a certain financial outlay, while the final NEP actually stops with saying that there will be an effort to increase the GDP to 6% for the education the proportion of GDP will be 6% for the education sector. So further to that, it does not make any mention of the financial commitment of the state. So these are the issues that will become sticky in the coming months and perhaps years. So the NEP itself, the final NEP has been released during the pandemic and it has not permitted a very vocal public debate. And we have not heard from states voicing their concerns about how these are actually going to be implemented in the manner in which the NEP has outlined. So these are issues that will definitely be taken up for the debates in the coming months, I think. However, I do feel that the center has to really make its firm financial commitments and enable the states to sort of also extend and sort of implement their commitment to realizing some of the policies and goals that have been laid out in the NEP. And these are important issues, and there has to be a spirit of cooperation which can help us get these things off the ground.
Thank you, ma'am, for sharing your insights on NEP. The discussion with you was very thought-provoking for the audience, wherein you highlighted the existing issues along with their implications. Okay, cut concluding remarks. Thank you, ma'am, for sharing your insights on NEP. The discussion with you was very thought-provoking for the audience, wherein you highlighted the existing issues along with the implication of NEP with regard to teachers. In your responses, we had tried to build. In your responses, you had tried to build a context of the existing issues pertaining to teachers and further leading the audience towards what NEP provisions mean in the context. While certain paths taken by NEP are welcome, there is dire need to have a well-thought purpose driven by evidence, a proper conceptualization of procedures, and a vision for the expected outcome. Thank you, ma'am.
That is all for today. We will be back with another episode shortly. This podcast is brought to you by the Center for Excellence in Teacher Education Initiative at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. Thank you for listening. Have a good day.